Today is Maundy Thursday, and we know it's the day when Jesus Christ had his last supper with his disciples. That particular supper was very special. It was actually reflecting back on something that happened in the Old Testament, and that is the Passover meal, which we read about and we read about in Exodus chapter 12. So please do turn with me to chapter 12 in Exodus. That's where I'll be basing myself, but at the same time bringing out some lessons that I think are important for us to reflect on at a time such as this, Maundy Thursday. It has been said that the New Testament is in the Old Testament concealed, and the Old Testament is in the New Testament revealed. In other words, when we look at the scriptures, both Old and New Testament, it's one message, but it's not as clear in the Old Testament until you read the New Testament where it is fully revealed. This is important for us to understand because actually the first Passover finds its fulfillment in the Lord's Supper, which we read about in John chapter 13. In particular there is a narration about the washing of the feet, but the context was actually the supper. And that's what was happening at that particular time, and we must not lose sight of that. And so Jesus Christ fulfills what was at first seen by Moses and instituted by God as the Passover. Now, if you have read the book of Exodus, you get to understand what was happening. I hope that at least all of us have at least some familiarity with the events before that. Because God came down and through Moses, he said, I'm going to take my children out of Egypt. And that's what we come to. He carries out, he does a number of miracles, a number of things that happen, a number of signs to Pharaoh, trying to tell Pharaoh, I must take my children out of Egypt. But unfortunately, Pharaoh remains rebellious, and he refuses to let Israel go. Until eventually, when we come to chapter 12, God says to Moses, just one more sign and Pharaoh will let the children of Israel go. And so what does he do? He promises this particular time that all the firstborns of Egypt will die. That's really what he's preparing them for. And so chapter 12, which we read, talks about the institution of a supper, which also includes the death of the Egyptian firstborn, but also the deliverance of the children of Israel. And he says, the Lord said to Moses in verse 1 there, and Aaron in the land of Egypt, this month shall be for you the beginning of months. It shall be the first month of the year for you. Tell all the congregation of Israel that on the 10th day of this month, every man shall take a lamb according to their father's houses, a lamb for a household. And if the household is too small for a lamb, then he and his nearest neighbor shall take another, shall take according to the number of persons, according to what each can eat, you shall make your count for the lamb. Your lamb shall be without blemish, a male a year old. You may take it from the sheep or from the goats, and you shall keep it until the 14th day of this month, when the whole assembly of the congregation of Israel shall kill their lambs at twilight. So that is the institution of the Passover. And of course, if you read the entire chapter, you'll get the fuller context of what actually happens in the institution of the first Passover. Because he goes on, then he promises, he says to them, if you read everything, I'm not going to read again everything, but he goes on and he says that when you kill the lamb, you shall use a plant called hyssop, dip it in the blood,
And you'll smear it on the doorposts so that when I come around, I will know that this particular house is protected, and then the firstborn in that house will not die. And so that's what the children of Israel eventually had to do to come out of the slavery in Egypt. Now, at that particular time, of course, we are talking about mainly political slavery or maybe even geographical slavery and so on and so forth. But I want to say to you, my brothers and sisters, the greatest tragedy in life is to be enslaved and yet feel free. I do remember where before I came to Christ, I really didn't realize I was a slave. I didn't realize my slavery. That even the language, the obscene language, the lies that I used to tell, and many other things, until I came to Christ. And I remember that first morning after turning to the Lord Jesus Christ, feeling a lightness like a load had been taken off my chest, my heart, and all of a sudden feeling free. Then I realized something had happened. I have since heard other people give similar testimonies of what God does when we turn to Him. And so the children of Israel, for them, it was mostly political slavery. But one can be politically free and yet still a slave. But also, at the same time, we need to bear in mind that you can be a slave and the emancipation is declared, but you don't get to enjoy it. When William Wilberforce managed to convince the British Parliament, and it was really very late in his life, that slavery should be outlawed, not all slaves became free. It continued for a long time. Similarly, in the United States, President Abraham Lincoln signed the Emancipation Proclamation, and he said, actually, some of the words there are very interesting, because the proclamation declared that all persons held as slaves within the rebellious states, which actually tended to be the southern states in the U.S., are and henceforth shall be free. In other words, they are free and they shall be free. But actually, they were never free, were they? They were never free. In fact, we know very well that even up to this past century, the African Americans have remained, discriminated against. A kind of slavery continues. And so it's quite possible for the emancipation to be made without necessarily people being free. Now, the Passover in Egypt, like what William Wilberforce did or Abraham Lincoln did, was God's declaration of emancipation from slavery, if we want to use the same kind of language. And this week that we have is actually God's declaration of emancipation. But in this case, while for them it may have been political freedom, political redemption, and being freed from Egypt, for us in the Lord Jesus Christ, it's much more than that. That it becomes very individualized, that you and I can be freed from sin. So the declaration of emancipation is not a declaration of emancipation politically. First and foremost, the most important is emancipation from sin. And the question that each one of us must ask is if we have taken care or we have taken hold of that emancipation. It was declared 2,000 years ago, but it does not mean that everybody has actually experienced it. Now, I'm going to say a few things because what I want to dwell on more is to look at what happened actually in Exodus and then relate it to what Jesus actually did for us. The first thing that I want to mention to you, or what I want to relate for you, is the first Passover and Jesus Christ, whom Paul calls in 1 Corinthians 5:7, our Paschal Lamb. The word Paschal being exactly meaning the same thing as the Passover. What did the Passover actually do? What does Jesus actually do for us today? And I want to bring before you three very important things that were intended in the Passover and definitely are meaningful for us as Christians today. The first one is recognition, first of all, that as human beings, we are born alienated from God. The Bible says, all have sinned and they have fallen short of the glory of God. Therefore, Jesus, our Paschal Lamb, and the Passover then, is that way that God uses to bring us together with God. And the theologians always have their words. They call it atonement. It's that reconciliation, if you wish, to bring us at one with God. That redemption. So the slaughtered lamb then was killed. Now, to understand that, you have got, first of all, to understand, what is it that separates us from God? It's our sin. Of course, we may say it very quickly, but quite often we do not understand how serious the problem of sin is. Habakkuk chapter 1, verse 13 says to us that God is so pure that he cannot look at sin. In other words, when there is sin in our lives, God cannot, it's not just about not having fellowship with us, but he cannot even look at us. He cannot look at us. And so we are separated from him. We are alienated from him. And as a result, Paul tells us in Romans chapter 6, verse 23, that the wages of sin is death. In other words, when you're a sinner, the only thing that you can expect to get from God is his wrath. Not mercy, but his wrath. The only thing you can get is to be completely separated from him. Now, that's similar to what happened in the Passover lamb. There was a separation there. It may have been political in other ways, but the slaughtered lamb died in the place of the children of Israel, a substitute for the Israelite firstborn. So the Egyptian firstborn died so that the Israelite firstborn may be delivered. In verse 27 of that same chapter that we read in Exodus, actually he says that same thing. He says, you shall say, it is the sacrifice of the Lord's Passover, for he passed over the houses of the people of Israel in Egypt when he struck the Egyptians but spared our houses. And the people bowed their heads and worshipped. So there is that redemption, that atonement, or atonement if you wish, where the lamb becomes the substitute, but in our case, Jesus becomes the substitute that we may go free. But the second thing that happened at Passover was purification. The application of the blood using the hyssop plant on the doorposts was actually intended for purification. I don't have the time to read each and every verse, but let me read for you verse 22 in that same chapter to tell us how it was instituted. He says, take a bunch of hyssop and dip it in the blood that is in the basin, and touch the lintel and the two doorposts with the blood that is in the basin. None of you shall go out of the door of his house until the morning. Now, if you read the rest of the scriptures, and I could give you these, if you wish to check out for yourself, in Leviticus chapter 14, verse 4 and 6, verse 4, 6, 49, 51, 52, and in Numbers chapter 19, you can pick up that actually that particular plant, hyssop, was used for ritual purification. And so at that particular time, what is happening? They'd use the hyssop, they put the blood on the doorposts and on the lintel, and the purpose is to say that the people that are inside here have been cleansed of all that would have alienated them from their God. And for that reason, they are not going to be destroyed. So purification was definitely another purpose for the Passover. But thirdly, the Passover was also intended for sanctification. The Israelites were consecrated. They were set apart. That's really what it is all about, the consecration. To be consecrated is to be set apart. Now, some of you probably realize today we are going to have Holy Communion over here. Now, you do not understand, in the Old Testament, the chalices, the patterns, and everything that is used, now that's language, by the way, let me call them cups and plates. it's easier for you rather than using this language that we clergy use so that we are separated from you. But those things that are used there are not used for anything else. They are only used for that purpose. That means they have been set apart. They have been sanctified. They have been consecrated. The other word, by the way, that I love very much is what we call clergy in our languages, some of our languages. And in my language, for example, a clergy person is called omwaule. Now, do you know what that means? Omwaule is a person set apart. And for those of us who are clergy, that actually is a high calling. It's a calling for us to be different, to be separate, not to be common, not to be involved in things that are unacceptable in the eyes of God. That's really what it means. So here we are, the children of Israel, they are told, kill the lamb, put the blood on the doorpost and the lintel, and it is the way that God is separating you from the Egyptians who are going to be destroyed, who are going to be killed. And that same chapter, actually, verse 46 and 48, he says, the time that the people of Israel lived in Egypt was 430 years. At the end of 430 years, on that very day, all the hosts of the Lord went out from the land of Egypt. It was a night of watching by the Lord to bring them out of the land of Egypt. So this same night is a night of watching kept to the Lord by all the people of Israel throughout the generations, taking them out, separating them, setting them apart. For what? It's not just a matter of separating them. It's actually, consecration has two sides. You know, sometimes when we talk about setting apart, we may look only at the fact that we've been separated, but we are actually set apart for God. That's really what the purpose was. And then the nation of Israel from that moment on would become a nation that is consecrated to God. Now, when you look at all those three things, we say there is atonement, there is purification, there is sanctification or consecration. This, in fact, is the work of the cross. That in the cross, we are brought in reconciliation, in one ment, if you wish, with God. There is atonement that happens. But we are also purified from our sins. And we are consecrated, set apart for Him. And that's why we can proclaim and we say that Jesus Christ is our Paschal Lamb. He has achieved, in fact, much more than just political or geographical separation. For Him, what He has accomplished is to make sure that our sins are forgiven once and for all. Now, the second thing that I want to talk about is God's emancipation proclamation. One of the things that is written in this, and I read it for you in verse 2, that this month shall be for you the beginning of months. I love that. That the month of emancipation, the month when God takes the children of Israel out of Egypt, becomes their January, if you wish. By the way, the calendar that we follow, the fact that we are celebrating Easter, this would actually be the beginning of their year for Israel. This is the Hebrew calendar. It would be beginning now. It does not begin January 1st, like for us we begin. So the Passover marks the beginning of months. Why? Because it's the month of deliverance. It's the month when the people have been saved. I love it when I read in John chapter 3, Jesus insisting to Nicodemus and saying to him, you must be born again. Yes, you were born to your mother physically, but the moment you are forgiven, you are delivered, you are saved from sin, that is your first month. Isn't that what he's saying even here? That becomes the first month for the children of Israel. It's the month of departure from slavery. And that Jesus, of course, this is like the being born again ourselves. Now, unfortunately, in our country, being born again has now just become a fashion. Everyone says, I'm born again. Born again, born again, born again. And the meaning of it, I no longer understand. To understand what it really means, you have to go back to 2 Corinthians chapter 5, verse 17, where he said, you are no longer old, now you have become a new creation. Now, the interesting thing about the use of that word, particularly in Greek, the word new that is used there, is not ordinary word new. You know, Greek is a very rich, especially classical Greek, was a very rich language. And the word new that is used there, I can go and buy myself a shirt. My wife gave me a shirt. This is not the first one that has been made out there. But when they use the word new, when Paul uses the word new, he's saying what you become is so completely new that the past no longer influences the new. So the new is completely new. And it's not something that you've had before. It is actually a new life. That is the challenge that as Christians we have. That with the moment you say, I am saved. And I remember this very well before I came to Christ. When I would hear people say, I am saved. What is the next thing that people look for? They look for newness. They look to see whether there is a transformation, whether there is a change. If there is no change, they say, ah, these 70 people, that one is just telling a lie. Now, when we are new, then like the Passover month, that is our first month. Redemption in Christ is an act of recreation, the beginning of a new life. So God's emancipation proclamation essentially is the beginning of a new life in our lives. But secondly, it is also salvation. This salvation is a celebration. The Passover feast, it was called a feast. You know, sometimes as Christians, we lose this. And we start, you know, walk around like we are not very happy. It's a feast. It's intended to be a time to celebrate. I've said it before here, that sometimes we talk so much against food that we will make people think that food is unnecessary to Christian celebration. It is. You should have good food. If you can afford it, why not? Get the best. When you have been emancipated, how can you fail to express joy? How can you fail to celebrate? So it is a celebration. God says to the children of Israel, this month shall be a month of celebration. This month shall be a time when you can even fellowship with other people. If the lamb is too much for your household, call in others. Enjoy it with others. Celebrate. Now, I don't know that we can have celebrations without eating. And I think eating is just part and parcel of it. I'm not saying that we overdo it. I'm simply saying that eating is part of celebration, isn't it? It is. And there's nothing wrong with that. We should not make people feel guilty that they are eating. Okay? But don't overdo it. Now, many Christians, unfortunately today, are becoming slaves in another way. They are becoming slaves because they become slaves of methodology and Christian cliches. Now, I'm going to say something here that I think will surprise some of you. I do not believe in this whole business of creating altars in the home. I believe in prayer. But now the altar has become another thing. They are telling people, people are actually even beginning to set up altars in their homes. Where do you get that in the scriptures? That's just enslaving yourself again. What about generational curse? Now, if Jesus has redeemed me, if his salvation is complete, there is no generational curse. What are you talking about? Don't be deceived as Christians. This whole business, show me in the scriptures. I can be educated, I can be informed, but as far as I'm concerned, altars, generational curse, those cliches are just making you slaves
of Egypt, they don't belong to the new life that we have in Christ. The work of Christ, what does the writer to the Hebrews tell us? He tells us that Jesus is able to save to the uttermost. No generational curse. Listen, in my background, I do have a witch doctor. I don't carry whatever he went through. Forget it. When I came to Christ, Christ forgave me. Christ saved me. Christ made me new. I'm not going to be held back from my celebration of this salvation because of what people say. And then altars, people are beginning. And you know what? Some of these things start out in a very good way. But before you realize it, you start now bowing to the altars and you think if there is no altar, there will be no prayer. That's how Satan enslaves us. Jesus has saved us. Let us keep the feast. Isn't that what the Bible says? Let us keep the feast. And so please keep the feast. I do not believe in generational curses or these altars. I believe in prayer. I believe in prayer. I don't have to set up an altar. No. I am a Christian because Jesus has saved me. Now, the third thing that I want to talk about here concerning this work of emancipation. This is a feast without sin. I already told you that the smearing of the blood on the doorposts is an act of purification. So we have a feast here without sin. First of all, from the sacrifice itself. It's a lamb without blemish, we are told. And by the way, the fact that he says you should only eat unleavened bread, leaven itself, Paul talks about it, is a symbol, is symbolic of evil. In other words, that this particular feast is a feast where Jesus takes care of all my sins. This feast is much more than deliverance from Egypt. It's definitely a salvation from sin. And God's judgment, which fell on the Egyptians, saved the children of Israel, and they did not die from the angel of death. Now, that does not mean that we may not fail. It's quite possible for us to fail, and indeed we do. It could be in our thoughts, and we must not take the problem of sin lightly. The problem of sin is very serious, and that's why he says, the wages of sin is death. But we must not think that Jesus Christ is incapable of taking care of all our sins. Repentance is not also a one-time act. Those people who are teaching that once you have been forgiven, you don't need to do any more repentance. Why do we repent? We repent because we have fallen, because we have sinned. Now, if you have sinned, if none of us, and I think I'm looking at people who all sin, if for you, you have been so delivered from sin that you never fall at all, whether in your thinking or in your words, on what you do or what you even fail to do. Because sometimes we look at the things that we do. But in our prayers of confession in the Church of Uganda, we repent not only about what we have done, which we ought not to have done, but also what we have failed to do, which we ought to have done. And actually, in the Old Testament, when God commands the children of Israel, he talks about willful sin and unwillful sin. In other words, sin that you do willfully, okay, you decide, you do it. But at the same time, there is sin simply because you've missed it. Sometimes we call these sins of commission and sins of omission, where you have omitted to do what you should have done. These are things that happen. However, what the Paschal lamb, what the Passover lamb does for us here
First of all, it must be without sin whatsoever. And I'm going to come back to that, particularly when I say a little bit more about Jesus. It must be without sin. That it must be, and the food is eaten without leaven, to completely get rid of any appearance of sinfulness as we come before God. And when we come to share in the Passover meal, which is the Holy Communion, by the way, the Last Supper, when we come to share in it, what is one of the things that actually the clergy call us to do? Is to repent of all our sins. And there is a prayer which we call the prayer of humble access. And what is the purpose for that? It is simply to say, I am unworthy. I may know, I may not even know whether I have actually sinned against God. And I'm saying I am unworthy. I remember many years ago hearing someone preaching, some of these excited preachers. And in the old prayer, if you look at, especially at some of the old prayer books, we, in the confession, there were these words, "We are, forgive us, miserable sinners." So this brother, in his excitement, trying to make little of what was being said, said, "I'm not a miserable sinner." Well, my friend, if you're not a miserable sinner, you are not even worth forgiving. That's it. Because sin causes misery. If you really know your sin before God, that is in itself something that should be causing you misery. So Christ has become our Paschal Lamb, who is sufficient for all time, for all people, unlike the lamb that the children of Israel had to kill. Is for all time, for all people, and it's unrepeatable. There is no need to repeat it, just like some of these others were being repeated. But fourthly, talking about this emancipation, I want to say something about that blood on the doorposts. The blood on the doorposts. And the blood of Jesus Christ now. We don't have to apply it physically, but we do know that he did shed his blood on his cross. And that blood on his cross is the blood under which we ourselves are covered. And that blood, when it was put on the doorposts, it was saying to the angel of death, these people are marked for deliverance, both now and in the future. The blood of Jesus, under which I now stand, the blood of Jesus that was shed on the cross at Calvary, as we shall be remembering tomorrow, tells me I have been marked for salvation both now and later. That's it. I've been marked for salvation. But not any blood would do. Like we have already noted, the lamb had to be without blemish. So we ask ourselves, what about the blood of our Lord Jesus Christ, our Paschal Lamb? It is the sacrifice without blemish. The sacrifice without sin. For two reasons. Let me just give you two. The first one, the very fact that Jesus was God's offer. God knew all the requirements for a sacrifice that would be acceptable. And so he gave his own son, God's sacrifice. It was given according to his own standards. God's standards. He had already said it would be without blemish. And so when he gives, what does he give? He gives a sacrifice without any sin whatsoever. It's God who gives it. This morning in my devotion, I was reading about the trial. Very interesting. You know, the trial of our Lord Jesus Christ. And here he is before Pilate. Poor man, this is in the Gospel of Luke. Poor man, he tried to see how he would wriggle out of this situation. He sent Jesus, he tried him, he said, but there is nothing. He sent him to Herod, thinking maybe Herod had better carry this problem. Jesus had become Pilate's problem. He goes to Herod. Herod asks questions. Jesus keeps quiet. He can't find any reason. He cannot write anything. And yet it was required you should be able to write what the offense was. But in the end, he sends him to Pilate without writing anything. He can't say what Jesus had actually done wrong. Why? Because this, and that's my second point, this Savior, who is our sacrifice, whether in the human eyes or in God's eyes, had absolutely no sin. There was nothing that could be brought. What did Pilate eventually write that he pinned on the cross? He said, he says, the King of the Jews. And then the Jewish leaders came to him and they said, no, you shouldn't write that. You put there, he said he's the King of the Jews. And he said, what I have written, I have written. Now, do you get killed for saying you're King of the Jews? You see, in the eyes of the law, Jesus was faultless. But how much more important that it was God himself who came and died on the cross, as we shall be remembering tomorrow, paid the price that you and I could not pay. You and I, if you have the blood of Jesus Christ covered under that blood, you're marked for deliverance. And that's why I can talk about heaven with confidence. Not because I've done anything. No. If it depended on me, friends, if it depended on me, when I feel good, I would say, now I think I'm ready for heaven. And when I don't feel good, I would say, now I'm not very sure if I'm good for heaven. But because it depends on the Son of God, the sacrifice that was given for you and for me, because it is his, therefore, I can say, as long as Jesus is my Savior, my salvation is sure today, is sure tomorrow, shall be sure right into heaven because of Jesus. So that's the emancipation that we have been able to experience. Now, let me finally say one more point, and that's blood. Why blood? In Leviticus chapter 17, verse 11, he says this, the life of the flesh is in the blood. And I have given the blood for you on the altar to make atonement for your souls. For it is the blood that makes atonement for the life. I did say already, because of our sin, we have to give life. The wages of sin is death. That's a very important point that Paul makes there, that because of sin, the only punishment that's due to us is the punishment of giving up our life. And so Leviticus here is saying is that, look, the blood suffices because the life that we are supposed to give up is in the blood. And therefore, the shedding of blood is what we need. In Hebrews chapter 9, verse 22, he says, indeed, under the law, almost everything is purified with blood. And without the shedding of blood, there is no forgiveness of sins. We have the blood of Jesus Christ. Like the first Passover, the Lord's Supper proclaims Jesus Christ. What we are going to celebrate today is a proclamation of the sacrifice that Jesus gave on that supper. He is our Paschal Lamb. The cross of Jesus becomes then the meeting place for God's mercy and God's wrath. God fulfills what he must do to take life, but at the same time, he fulfills what only he himself can give, because all sin, as David reminds us in Psalm 51, all sin is against God, against you and you only. Oh Lord, I have sinned. And therefore, he shows mercy. So there is God's mercy, there is God's wrath as we go through this week. And Christ, I'm reminding you, my brothers and sisters, has once for all put away sin by the offering of himself. Complete salvation. He's able to save to the uttermost. Please let no one ever put you in doubt concerning your faith, concerning your salvation. Your salvation does not depend on you, on what you do. It does not even depend on which church you go to. That's not what it depends on. It does not even depend on how many times you pray. A church may be called born again. That does not save anyone. The salvation that we have is only in Christ. Let us not be deceived by anything else. It is at the cross that we have full grace for a sinner that cannot find any salvation anywhere. What does God say in verse 13, in chapter 12? He says, the blood shall be a sign for you on the houses where you are. And when I see the blood, I'll pass over you. When I see the blood today, would say, when I see the blood of Jesus Christ, I'll pass over you. Covered under the blood of Jesus Christ, which suffices for everything. The Lord's Supper is not only a commemorative ritual, looking back at how we were recreated, but is also an act of expectation as we look forward to the time of the consummation. So, brothers and sisters, today is Maundy Thursday. As we celebrate, as we remember and share the meal with the Lord Jesus Christ, what is it that Jesus said to his disciples? He said, I will not eat of this until I look forward to eating it with him in heaven. What about you? May God bless you.